All right, here we go. So normally you got to find the neutral axis. If you see symmetry, this is kind of a weird one, but if you see symmetry above and below, like in a shape, and we're just talking like mass symmetry, it doesn't have to, like if I'm thinking in the y direction, right, up and down, is it symmetrical? I got 4 inches here, I got 4 inches there. I have the same amount of mass here as I have above the x-axis, right? So if we went through the centroidal calculation, it's gonna put that thing right in the middle of this system because it is symmetrical top and bottom. It's a little bit rotated, but that doesn't matter for centroid, right? And if you look at it the other way, like, oh yeah, it's symmetrical that way too. This axis would be right down through the middle of it. If you don't believe that, or if you're not sure, then run the centroidal equation to prove it. But it's true in this case. If this was three, then it's not true, right? It has to be exactly the same top and bottom. So on this one, we can make the assumption, hey, this is symmetrical about that middle point. In both directions, it's symmetrical, okay? So that means we can go straight to the inertia. And when I think about inertias, I'm gonna think about individual shapes and their inertia and where that is compared to the centroidal. This is the neutral axis, centroidal axis of the entire thing, right? We're just making that assumption. I'll call it neutral axis. But if I think about this top piece coming across and this top bottom piece coming across, this rectangular inertial axis is way up here. It is not here, right? When that happens, we can't just add them. We need the inertia still, but then we have to put it into this equation to get it to the x-axis. So essentially we're taking this inertia, moving it this far, which we call D, the distance. And we're taking this inertia and we're moving it this far, again, D, and you do them individually. Now I broke it up this way, so this middle piece, it's right at the neutral axis, right? I don't have to transfer that one. It's right there. I think that might've been an email coming in, some kind of chimey thing. Does that make sense? So there's three shapes, right? There's one here, there's one here, and then there's one here. Three shapes. The third shape, its centroidal axis is at XX. We don't have to transfer that one. Calculate it, add it to this one transferred and this one transferred. And these are gonna be the same equation, right? Because we have symmetry. So I really only have to do one of them, make sure I multiply by two and I'm good. All right, but what you first have to find out is those individual inertias. So I gotta find out the inertia of this number one shape, which I'll call IX of one, just like we did before. It's a rectangle, base is five, I think, comes all the way across is what I did. So it's 4 plus 1, 5, and then the 1 is cubed over 12. And then I could write IX2, but it's the same, isn't it? Yeah, the base is 5, the height is 1 cubed over 12. So IX2 equals IX1 equals the equation. We just have to remember to double it, but they're the same. All right, so what's my number, 5/12? Pretty pathetic inertia. 4, 1, 6, 6, 6 inches to the fourth. So that is the inertia about that axis right up here, or this axis right here. Once you get that, then that becomes the inertia about its own origin, right? So we plug it in and we say, okay, so Ix is going to equal, in other words, I'm going to transfer this inertia to the x axis. And this is of shape one. Point 41666 inches to the fourth plus area of that shape, right? Area of that shape, which is what? 5 times 1? 5 inches squared. Because you can only transfer one at a time. And then D, the transfer distance. So that's going to be from the axis to the centroidal axis. So how far is that? Careful. It's 8 from here to here, right? So half of that is 4, and then another half. So 4 to here, and then a half, 4.5. And that gets squared. And that's the part that we tend to forget. Don't forget to square your d distance, 4.5. All right, run this number. I'm a little larger than that, but I'm gonna do it again. Seems too big, mine does. Yeah, you gotta be right, because 4 times 4 is 16, 16 times 5. Yeah, I got the same number. That's all right. That's why we practice. I got 101. 101.666? Yeah. So check that out. This inertia about its own centroid was what? 0.41? But because it's a certain distance away from the neutral axis, when we transfer it, goes way up. So even though it's not in a strong position, it's giving us a lot of good inertia value because it's a long ways from the neutral axis. That's why you see these I shapes. They're not really called I shapes, but that's what the normal person calls it, an I beam. They're really W shapes. Really tall and kind of skinny. The further away you get that flange, the more strength you have to resist bending. So this shape actually helps a lot because it's away from the neutral axis. And when you transfer it, that squaring of the distance is huge. That really drives it up, okay? And remember, we get two of them because we have one here and one here. So really, Ix, the total, is gonna be the inertia of this critter, which we haven't done yet, so we have to do that one, right? Because it's already at the neutral axis. So what is that? Let's do that one real quick. Ix of 3, base is 1, height is 8, base height cubed over 12. That's going to be a big number. So I get that one. I don't have to transfer that one. I can put it right in. Right? So this is I3. And then I need 2 of these transferred inertias 101.666, right? Because this is I of 1 and 2. Oh, look at what my calculator says. 42. That's because I'm dyslexic. Isn't that so weird when that happens? Like, I would have bet you money, except for I know I mix up numbers at times. So thank you. 42. So what'd you get for total? $246, what I get pretty much rounds up to $246. No, I mean, mine's 245.99999. So I would definitely round to 246.00. Yeah. But, you know, I could be carrying less or more significant. You know, I do a lot of storing and retrieving, that kind of thing. So even though I write down these 3 sixes, I get like 15 sixes. So we could be slightly off. That's okay. Yeah. No. Maybe I'm not understanding completely.
If the pencil axis of the other shapes is different in both x and y respects.
Which is what we have. My y's do not lie on the same axis. So I would have to do this again, and this becomes the transfer distance. For the other direction, yeah. So I'd have to calculate IYs. This one is in the correct location, so I don't have to transfer it again, right? But this one would have to get transferred. This one would have to get transferred. It's just gonna be much smaller numbers. So, does that make sense? Yeah. You could, yep. You can just run it again on its side, yep. Just know that when you read the table, you can't flip. The table's in one position. So you have to flip X and Y if you want to flip the shape. I know that's a lot of flipping, but I think you get what I mean. You do got to be careful with that. That can get, what's hard is when you get an out of position. So we do this a lot. I do this a lot because it's easy. So if you really need to drive up a standard W shape, you can just lay a C shape on top. It's an easy weld for the welders. It's easy to put on. If nothing's mounting up here, or maybe this is on the bottom, either way, it's just an easy manufacturing process to drive this W shape up like crazy. Way better than actually sizing this thing up. When you get big on these, they get heavy. So this would be much lighter, but it would drive that inertia value up like we need to, right? The problem is now this critter is not in the position of the chart. So when you want X, you got to read Y. Because in the back of the book, it's Y, but it's not Y here. It's XX and XX, right? And then where's the composite? Composite's in here somewhere. I'll call it a double X. So that's the neutral axis of the system. This is the neutral axis of the W shape. Here's the neutral axis of the C shape, right? Do they all line up? Negative. So now I have to transfer. So this is my transfer distance for the W shape. This is the transfer distance for the C shape. But I gotta know where that is. Well, that's chapter 7. Like, oh, where is Y bar? Y bar is the summation of AY over A. That's where Y bar is. And then you go to work, figure out like where this stuff is. This is a really weird number normally, and you're given it to right there for the C shape. So then you have to add D to it, which is the total height of this thing, because you're gonna put your axis down here. Anyway, gets complicated. It is really neat. What you need is a big picture. Don't make your picture small. If you make a tiny picture and then you start putting all this stuff on, pretty soon you just can't see it and it gets confusing. So they're nice in that I don't have to calculate I for the C shape, I just look it up. And I don't have to calculate I for the W shape, I just look it up. But I gotta figure out like where they are and how to transfer them. Good? Take some practice. So we're gonna do that. We're gonna do some practice. All right, let's get this stopped. Bye to online land, whoops.